When the Holy Spirit of God gave you spiritual life, He also did some other things for you that forever secure your salvation in Jesus Christ so that you can never lose your salvation. The first thing He did is that He circumcised the body of your flesh away from your soul so that your sins can no longer blemish your soul. He also baptized you into the body of Jesus Christ, and then He raised you up to be seated in heaven with Jesus so that you can never be thrown into hell. We're going to study these three things today. And the first one is called spiritual circumcision. Now, most people understand the physical operation of circumcision, where the foreskin of a male is surgically removed. But in salvation, according to Colossians chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, there is a spiritual circumcision, in whom also you are circumcised, with the circumcision made without hands, and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ, buried with Him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with Him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised Him from the dead. You see, in this operation of God, the body of the sins of your flesh has been removed so that it is impossible for your soul to ever sin again. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 9, we see the consequence of this spiritual circumcision. John says, "Whosoever is born of God doth not commit sin, for his seed remaineth in him, and he cannot sin because he is born of God." Now, you know something? Your sin in your flesh will continue to be operative. Your flesh is going to continue to sin because sin still dwells in it. As Paul said in Romans chapter 7 and verse 17, he said, "It is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me." Let's look at the whole context of Romans chapter 7 so you can see it for yourself, beginning with about verse 15. Here's what Paul says about this wicked flesh. "For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that I do not. But what I hate, that do I." Then in verse 16 he says, "If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For the will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do." Now, you know what? That is a classic explanation of sin that is dwelling in you. He said, "It is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me." And that's because our flesh still sins. But in order to guarantee that our spiritual life will remain in us, God circumcises our flesh away from our soul, and that way the sins of the flesh only affect the flesh and can never affect the soul again. Praise the Lord for spiritual circumcision. The second thing we want to look at is spiritual baptism. According to 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse 13, the Bible says, "For by one Spirit are we all baptized into one body, whether we be Jews or Gentiles, whether we be bond or free, and have been all made to drink into one Spirit." You know what? We become a literal part of the body of the Lord Jesus Christ. So much so that Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5 and verse 30 that we are members of His body, of His flesh, and of His bones. Listen, this spirit baptism is not a water baptism. You know why? Because this baptism puts you literally into the body of Christ. And you can tell by what Peter said when he witnessed the salvation of Cornelius and his household during his preaching. You know what he did? He described their salvation like this. He's giving an explanation of how they got saved in Acts chapter 10 when he preaches to the council that's gathered together in Acts chapter 11. In verse 15 he said, "And as I began to speak, the Holy Ghost fell on them," that's on Cornelius and on his household, "as on us at the beginning. Then remembered I the word of the Lord, how that he said, John indeed baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost." Now notice the distinct contrast between water baptism and spirit baptism. Paul gives you a great explanation of spirit baptism in Romans chapter 6 and verse 3 through 7. Now, I know this is a little bit of a passage, but you want to get this. This isn't water baptism. This is spirit baptism. And here's what he says. He said, "Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection, knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of the sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin." Guess what? That is a fantastic baptism. Since we become a part of Christ's body, we spiritually went through his literal death, his literal burial, and his literal resurrection. And there's no way in the world that a water baptism can do that for you. Notice, even our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed. That's verse 6. Then we were baptized into his death. That's verse 3. Then we're buried with him by baptism into death. That's verse 4. Did you notice it's buried with him, baptized into his death, crucified with him? You see, like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. That's verse 4. Because of our death with Christ, we are now freed from sin. Verse 7 says, "Now he that is dead is freed from sin." And because of our resurrection with Christ, we are now alive forevermore. That's spiritual baptism. And that's a wonderful thing. But that's not all. We've looked at spiritual circumcision. We've looked at spiritual baptism. Now we're going to look at spiritual resurrection. When Jesus Christ ascended up to heaven 40 days after his resurrection, he was seated at the right hand of God the Father. In Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3, we see this from the scripture. The Bible says it this way, "Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high." In other words, if you could go to heaven right now and see Jesus Christ, you know what? You would see his body seated right next to God's throne on the right hand side. Well, since we have been baptized into his body, and since his body is seated next to God's throne, you know what? Then you and I have been seated together with him next to God's throne. And that's exactly where we are. Look with me in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 6. Because you see, in this passage of Scripture, our resurrection. We were saved in verse 5 and then verse 6, "And hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." My young Christian friend, you are already in heaven spiritually, simply awaiting the death of your body so that you can be absent from the body and present with the Lord when you die. According to 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8, "We are confident," Paul said, "and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord." You know something? Because of spiritual circumcision, because of spiritual baptism, and because of spiritual resurrection, you are sealed in Jesus Christ until the day of your redemption. Two verses in Ephesians tell us that, chapter 1 and verse 13, and chapter 4 and verse 30. Ephesians 1:13 says, "In whom ye also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise." You know what? There is no possibility of you ever losing your salvation because of these three things. And thank God for that. Amen.